Hello, everybody. This is GeorgeAnn Hughes, and this is The Byte Show. And it's a real pleasure to have Catherine Austin Fitz with us. And she has a fantastic website. It is solari.com, and that's solari.com. And there's a subscription newsletter. There is plenty of free articles and very interesting articles, I might add, on her website. So go have a look. Catherine.
GeorgeAnn.
Yes.
It's so nice to be with you.
My goodness, I tell you what. These phones are something else. I wanted to ask you, what do you know about this thing that they're working on called the TPP?
The Trans-Pacific Partnership. I've reviewed some of the leaked materials.
Oh.
And I've listened to some commentary, but I'm in no way, shape, well informed. What I'm assuming just from the material I've read is that once again, this is yet again another trade negotiation that's being used to help, increasingly centralize control and give private corporations the ability to overcome local laws and regulations to kind of streamline their access to markets and their organization of their operations.
Mm.
So it's basically a way to centralize the economy.
Yeah. Well, tell me if this sounds right. I heard that if, for example, say your state does not want Monsanto in your state growing or operating in any way, that gives Monsanto the right to come in and sue your state for lost revenue that they never got.
My understanding is conceptually that is basically the idea.
Oh, boy.
Now, how it translates into specifics in this particular trade agreement. And what they're looking for is a way to centrally override national or local sovereignty.
Yes. Yes. Oh. Where do they come up with these things from hell? I mean, and it's like no matter how we protest these things, they just do what they want.
Well, there are a couple questions. You know, clearly there is an effort that's being made very forcefully top-down to centralize the economy.
Oh, yeah.
And the question is why? What's that about? You know, one theory is that, if absolute power corrupts absolutely, so if somebody can do it, then clearly if I don't do it, then, the other guy will and I'll lose.
Oh,
so part of it is kind of a race to the bottom spiritually.
Yes.
I think another thing that's happening in defense of the people doing it, if you are the Anglo-American Alliance and you've ruled the planet for, say, 500 years, and you've done it through the central banking warfare model, that model's not going to last.
Right.
You need a new model. And so there's a real race to get yourself in a position to control in a new model.
Yeah.
And I think that's part of what you're seeing. To me, part of it is that the energy probably can't be the standard behind the reserve currency forever. And so there's an effort to get food and other controls that, will supplant when new energy technology changes the fundamental nature of the energy market. So that's part of it. Now, you and I can say, and I've heard many commentators say, oh, bad Anglo-American Alliance for wanting to do that. Well, you know, the reality is if the Anglo-American Alliance doesn't, somebody else will, and that's going to be, you know, very potentially dangerous for the Anglo-American Alliance. So part of this is you have various factions who don't see a way to get, you know, to get to a peaceful world through collaboration.
Yeah.
They think they need, you know, they need the upper hand if they're going to come out of this thing in a reasonable situation. And defense, in defense of their position, if you look at what the average American expects for them to accomplish, they can't really accomplish those things without doing this.
Wow.
Well, there's a bit of a double bind going on here. So it's more than a bit. There's hundreds of them. But, you know, so the world is ruled by power, and after you've run around for 500 years slapping everybody around, you can't just suddenly show them your jugular and say, oh, let's cooperate.
Yeah, that's true.
That ain't so easy. So I think it speaks to the fact that we're coming into a shift, and then, of course, behind the scenes, what some people argue is that the push for centralization is being very much driven by the need to deal with the UFO and black budget situation. And, of course, that's the big, you know, question mark hanging up over all of this is, where's all that money been going for 50 and 60 years? You know,
yeah.
Is the U.S. Navy really traveling the galaxy in spacecraft, as people like Gary McKinnon have suggested? And, you know, what's that all about? So I was just watching a wonderful interview by Elon Musk, who runs Tesla and has a company called SpaceX.
Yeah.
And he basically said, look, you know, why sit around this planet waiting for, you know, for an inevitable extinction moment?
That's
why
right.
Why not create options and get out there?
Yeah.
So whatever's going on in terms of space weather and space, or, you know, friendly visitors from space, you know, I think that's, if anything has driven this push for centralization, it's that. And yet, you know, that's not, in most circles, a socially acceptable conversation to have, which to me is the most frustrating thing about our situation, GeorgeAnn, is why can't I talk about the things that are absolutely driving most of the things that are painful to me? Why do I have to pretend, you know, not to talk, you know, why do I have to pretend that they don't exist and they're not there? That to me is the most frustrating thing in the world.
Oh, you're not kidding. Boy. Whoa. You said a whole mouthful in that sentence.
Good.
Wow. You know, I watched on RT today, and they had a fellow on there. His name is Robert Zubrin. And he's the president of the Mars Society. And he's talking about traveling to Mars.
Well, it was 200 that they I forget what the name of the organization is, but maybe it's that one. They invited applications for people who
yes.
wanted to colonize Mars. And this, you know, right now with current technology, this is a one-way trip. You don't come
yeah.
back.
Yeah.
And 200,000 people signed up. Now, let me explain how dramatic that is. In the first 30 days, only 50,000 people signed up for Obamacare.
Yeah.
200,000 signed up to leave and go to Mars on a one-way trip. Now, what does that tell you?
Yeah. Boy. Hold on a minute, Catherine.
Okay.
I'm sorry, everybody. I've got a throat issue tonight. So, yes, Mars. Yeah, this fellow was talking about the initial thing would be a one-way trip, and then there would be, you know, months of travel back to this planet, and they would have a regular kind of rotation set up. And he talked about the colonization and the stuff they would need, and it was very interesting, Catherine.
I thought that the trip that was being planned was a one-way.
Yeah, the initial trip.
The initial trip.
Yes.
Okay.
Is one way. Yeah. It's very interesting. And, you know, I think that they, in capital letters, have known for quite a while that Mars could support life. But
well, I don't know if you saw the announcement this week. NASA is planning on starting a garden on the moon.
Oh, you're kidding.
No, it's up on my blog, salary.com/blog.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah. Yeah.
I saw some interesting articles there tonight, but I did not see that one.
If you, it may be off the homepage. If you click back, you should get it. It was up earlier this week.
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah.
Oh, gardening on the moon. My goodness. Well, you know, there are just billions, trillions of dollars that are missing. What do you think they're, where do you think it went?
There are a couple of possibilities. One is that we think of grossly oversimplified, and I'm just going to say this conceptually to help you understand the dynamics.
Okay.
Say at the beginning of the 90s, we had $100 trillion of assets, $100 trillion of liabilities, basically in the North American system.
Mm-hmm.
And a group of people got together and said, look, let's shift $40 trillion out of low-earning activities and shift it into, you know, high-earning activities. Among other things, let's create an endowment so we can fund the U.S. government without the taxpayer.
Yeah.
You know, but it'll be a private secret government. But, you know, we'll put up an endowment. Let's say we'll put up an endowment of $30 trillion, and if we can earn 10% a year, that's $3 trillion. Or if, you know, we only earn 5%, it's $1.5 trillion.
Mm-hmm.
And that's enough to kind of run everything without, you know, without having to be bothered with Congress and the laws. And then we have another $10 trillion for black budget technology and space.
Mm.
And so I, you know, now some of it could clearly have been pulled out and reinvested in the emerging markets, because in fact, you know, if you pull it out of North America and put it into the emerging markets at the low and then take it up,
mm-hmm.
then you're going to have more than just the $40 trillion. So let's say you can take your $40 trillion and convert it into $60 trillion if you're smart, and if you're really lever it up and play all sorts of games, which I think they could do, you could get even more. So you can create an endowment for a one-world government, and you can fund the initial rounds of the space program that we're clearly up to. I mean, we see NASA and the administration announce, you know, that from now on, basically, they're switching to a model where everything which is discovered in space is private and privately owned.
Yeah.
And since then, the space race has been on.
Yeah.
So I think, you know, I think a lot of it is going into building out the infrastructure that the black budget technology permits, and reengineering the industrial base for a world where it's not basically going to be run on a cost-plus basis driven by Congress and government.
Mm-hmm.
So it's basically privatization now. What that leaves us now is that we have $100 trillion of liabilities in the governmental systems, and now instead of having $100 trillion of assets, we have $60 trillion of assets, because 40 done gone.
Yeah.
And everybody's sitting around saying, oh my God, the world's going to collapse. No, it's not. The legacy systems are going to collapse. They're going to grind slowly. You know, they're going to reconcile $100 trillion of liabilities to to $60 trillion of assets. But those $40 trillion, which are now turned into 60 or 100 or whatever they've turned into, are being reinvested. And, you know, that economy is growing and is strong. Another way to look at it is, they said, why should we allow all this money to pay for nice retirements and nursing homes? So let's shift it out and put it into, you know, much more productive assets.
Mm-hmm. So that's where the food stamp money goes.
Well, I think, you know, part of, you've seen an explosion of government subsidy.
Yeah.
And part of it is, they said, look, we'd rather shift everything, you know, sort of rebalance labor globally and rebalance the global economy and do it in a way that puts us in control of the global economy. And basically we were just going to pay everybody in America a small stipend, whether it's unemployment or disability or welfare or food stamps, to basically, you know, sit up and sit down and shut up and leave us alone while we run everything.
Oh, boy. Well, that sounds like they've got some very long-range fancy plans. You know,
well, the people who govern have very long range. I mean, they're very long range thinking. They're very strategic in their thinking.
Mm-hmm.
And they think very differently than the general population. In
oh,
my
yeah.
experience. And it's funny because I was very much trained in that world. I was, when I was on Wall Street, I was flying to Detroit once, and I was the stewardess on the flight was standing right next to my aisle.
Mm-hmm.
And the plane hit an air pocket and went to a nosedive, which went on for a surprising amount of time.
Oh, boy.
And the stewardess let out a scream, screaming, "Oh, my God, we're all going to die."
Oh, my God.
And when she did, I realized, oh, you know, this nosedive is a little scary. And as soon as she screamed, I said, "I need a plan." And it took me literally about 3 seconds to realize I couldn't plan my way out.
Yeah.
There was no oh. plan. I might as well, you know, thank the good Lord for a nice life. And, you know, so I started to make a list of the people who had already passed who I was looking forward to seeing.
Oh, my goodness. Oh, Catherine.
That was funny. But, you know, but it took me literally 3 seconds to realize, oh, wait, you know, there is no plan. You're going to die.
Yeah. Well, you know, that's a news article came out about Greece and how desperate some people are over there. They can't feed their kids, and they are actually injecting themselves with HIV because they get a stipend then if they've got HIV.
Well, we've seen that here. I have friends who retired as a teacher.
Yeah.
Because they were so pressured to sign statements saying that the kids were, attention deficit disorder or other problems, so their parents could get the disability checks they needed essentially to feed them.
Oh, my gosh.
So, no, you're seeing tremendous financial incentives throughout our economy to say, you know, you or your child is disabled so that you can get the money you need to survive.
Wow.
Yeah, it's not, believe me, it's not a pretty picture what's going on.
No.
You well know.
It's not. And, I mean, I don't see how it can be fixed. I think the whole thing needs to be totally trashed and start over. I mean, in this country.
Well, I don't think, you know, I'd be careful how you say that because I'm a great believer in evolution.
Yeah.
I think that when you trash something, you invite the people who now have stolen all the money. It gives them the upper hand. So, and I think things are far less dire than they appear. There's a wonderful radio show host who says, you know, our situation is far too dire for the luxury of realism.
Oh, boy.
And I look at things spiritually, and spiritually they look very different than they do on the face. And I would just say, I'm working on our year-end wrap-up on the Solari Report, and one of our chiefs, we go back and look at the top stories of 2013. You know what I think the biggest story in North America was in 2013?
What?
Guns won.
Guns won?
Guns won. I assure you, the Obama administration had promised Mr. Global, if they got the nod and won the election, they would basically outlaw guns at the federal level. And they did everything they could.
Oh.
You know, that was a rigged deal. It was planned. It was rigged top down. They could not get it done. And they could not get it through Congress. Now, that is amazing. When Congress... Do you know how strong the will of the people has to be to get Congress to vote the will of the people?
Oh, yeah.
Against Mr. Global? That is absolutely phenomenal. But guns won.
Why?
And that is a very powerful statement.
Yes, it is. why did they promise they were going to get rid of the guns?
Well, you know, I can only conjecture, but I think if you look at what's being planned with real estate, the Trans-Pacific Partnership, with Amazon delivering, you know, groceries and drones.
Yeah.
Do you know what's going to happen to those drones in Mississippi? People are going to have fun shooting them down.
Yeah, they will here too.
You know, it's going to be skeet shooting time, except it's not going to be skeets, it's going to be Amazon's drones. So I think what's, you know, I think all the big money in the world is saying, look, we're planning on moving in and completely reengineering and privatizing everything.
Oh, boy.
We don't want, I mean, let's walk through the numbers.
Okay.
I buy a house thinking that I have a job and I have good employment prospects. It turns out I don't. It turns out I was fraudulently induced, and now I'm stuck with a mortgage and an upside-down house.
Yeah.
I offer to work the house out, you know, a write-down of, say, $100,000 on the debt. The bank, Fannie Mae, all these guys turn me down.
Yeah.
They turn around and sell the property to a big hedge fund for $25,000. Okay?
Mm-hmm.
In fact, I get stuck with an anti-deficiency judgment in some states.
Oh, boy.
Now, I was willing to offer them much more money, you know, but instead of doing a deal with me that will give them far more money, they turn around and stuff it at a reduced price into a hedge fund. What's that about when, in fact, I, as a taxpayer, have just bailed them out?
Yeah.
So I just paid for the house three times. I paid for the sweet deal into the hedge fund.
Yeah.
I paid for the house, you know, in a fraudulent deal, now that we know what's really going on. And I paid for the house by bailing out the banks.
Gee.
Okay? And I paid for it a fourth time. Because on a per-person basis, there's $14,000 missing from the federal government that was disappeared through the accounts in that big bank run as agent for the federal government. The New York Fed is depository for the U.S. government. So I just paid for the house four times and I don't have it, and in walks this institutional investor with a sweetheart deal. How am I going to feel about that? And if you're that institutional investor, you're saying, look, I don't want these people to have guns. When I take their home away from them and they realize how they've been played, I don't want them having guns. So I thought it was the real estate interest, but if you look at some of the other things, whether it's Trans-Pacific Partnership or the drones, I just think all that institutional capital is saying, look, if we're going to do this to people, we don't want them having guns. It's too dangerous. We don't want them blaming us.
That's almost humorous.
Well, but here's the thing: if you're gonna basically steal people's retirement savings,
right,
in illegal forms, breaking the law,
yes,
you don't want them having guns, because as long as they have guns, it's much harder to do that. I mean, here's the interesting thing: I mean, the day they pull in the guns is the day it's easy to cancel Social Security.
Oh yeah, yeah.
So.
Well, I can't see them pulling in everybody's guns. I know people around here. No way. No way. And I know people in other communities that feel the same way. I mean, they come and try to do that. One phone call, and the cops would be surrounded by thousands of people in a minute, you know.
Well, actually, where I am, I think the cops would be on our side, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm.
Anyway, so I think it's a wonderful example of how smart the American people really are. You know, we don't want to talk about it. We don't want to shove it around, but we know that we cannot trust the governance system at this point.
Right. Right. Well, when we talked last time, you were saying, you know, a community-based economy, kind of a cooperative among your friends and neighbors and people. And I think that is some of the best advice anybody could give, growing your own food. You know, depending on each other, your neighbors, not...
Well, here's the thing. It's great if you can do it. Mm-hmm. You know, we're in a situation where the corruption locally is as great as the corruption is federally.
Yes.
So I think you have to be very, very careful. But there is no doubt that the first and most important thing you want is resilience.
Yes.
And resilience starts locally with having, you know, not being alone, having people who, you know, you have the equivalent of an affinity group with, and you're about helping each other succeed in this environment.
Yeah.
And then part of that is anything you can do to create a fresh food supply is, you know, very important if you can do it.
Oh, that's right.
Right.
And, you know, Catherine, my head is just spinning.
Uh-huh.
There's no way these fraudsters can actually hide unless they go into underground bunkers. And, you know, Cliff High put out a report. I mean, there's going to be hangings. There's going to be...
No, I don't agree with that.
Oh.
I don't agree with that. I mean, look at what has gone on. Look at how much money's been stolen. Look at the lawlessness and the criminality. There haven't been hangings.
Yeah.
There haven't been shootings. Nobody... I mean, it's quite extraordinary.
Yeah.
And I think part of it is because the American people are very smart. And they know that that's not a winning strategy. If anything, that's going to give Mr. Global an excuse to come down harder.
Mm-hmm.
So I think they've been remarkably savvy about understanding that.
Well, I think that a lot of that, too, has to do with there's an awful lot of people on sedative-type drugs in this country.
Well, they're on government welfare.
Yeah.
So of various kinds, or government subsidies, or government checks, or government jobs. So government is funding a lot of household income. In many counties, directly or indirectly, government controls more than 50% of household income.
Oh, boy.
So whether you have financial methadone or you have a whole slew of drugs, I mean, and one thing, make no mistake about it, everybody started eating GMO food in the mid-90s.
Yes.
And many, many people are exhausted from absence of nutrition.
Yes. That's right.
Right. So, you know, if you've ever had a dog who was very aggressive and ill-behaved,
mm-hmm.
and, you know, just unbelievably hard to get to train,
mm-hmm.
it's real simple. If you feed them rotten food for a year, they have no energy and they become very easy to control.
Yeah.
Right. So,
yeah.
So we're in a similar kind of situation in terms of, you know, the general population. So they're, and that's not to, you know, I have a wonderful Soleri report with a great scientist on entrainment technology and the use of entrainment.
Oh.
But, you know, if you look at what that network and system does, and I really refer you to that whole report because it's complicated, but if you, whether it's the financial controls or the drugs or the food or the water, and then you add to it the entrainment, I think, you know, I don't see how you get to hangings.
How you get what? Oh, the hangings.
You get to hangings. I mean, you've got the NSA listening, you know,
yeah.
to every person all the time. And from what I've seen, the feedback loops, you know, I went through litigation with the federal government.
Yes.
So I got to sort of see the Edward Snowden system up close and personal.
Yeah.
The feedback loops are extraordinarily tight.
Hmm.
So, you know, we live in, I don't know if you've ever seen the movie The Truman Show, but we live in The Truman Show.
Oh, boy.
So I don't see... There's a wonderful new movie or documentary, if you haven't seen it, called Terms and Agreements.
I haven't seen it.
And it's about the terms and agreements you sign when you, you know, when you participate in an online service. And it has a story, one or more stories about a guy being arrested because of things they said on Facebook.
Yeah.
And
that's really happened.
Oh yeah. Oh yeah. So I'm telling you, the lockdown is very, very invasive and very, very complete. So I just don't see hangings happening.
Mm.
But But what I do see is, you know, I see, if you look at the victories on homeschooling, if you look at the victories on swine flu, if you look at the victory this year on guns, I just think we're going to have to get to a point where on a given issue where we just say no.
Yeah. Yeah. But they don't listen, you know. I mean...
Oh, they do listen.
You think so?
Absolutely. You know, they're listening all the time.
Well, yeah, that kind of listening. But I mean, writing your senator or whatever, they don't...
Well, all of that helps. But if I'm a senator and Mr. Global calls me up and says, either you vote no or I will have your children killed.
Yeah.
What do you do?
Yeah.
You can't, you know, you can write me all the letters in the world, but if they're going to kill my child, what am I going to do?
No, that's right.
So we need to be in a position where, you know, right now we have a group of people who are operating above the law with impunity.
Oh, you're not kidding.
So the question is, how do you organize to deal with that? And you can't organize to deal with it unless you can see it.
Yeah.
So you and I are having a conversation about that.
Yeah.
How do we see that? How do we deal with it? And then the other thing we have to do is to say, okay, let's look at their situation and let's look at their legitimate issues. And the first thing you'll discover is we don't understand what it's like to sit in their shoes and what they're dealing with. We can guess. But we really don't know. And I can tell you from the extent to which I was exposed to people in those positions, which was a long time ago, and I know that things have changed.
Yeah.
They were not bad people. They were, the ones I dealt with were generally as, if not more enlightened than the people I've dealt with throughout society. They were not bad people. You cannot explain this by saying, oh, they're bad people.
Yeah.
They were not bad people. They were people who had to deal in the system with the choices they were presented with.
Mm.
Now, we've reached, you know, we've had 20 years of a serious cycle of disrespect.
Yes.
Between the leadership and the general population. But the message from the general population is we want a bigger check this year, and as long as we get our check, we don't care. That's the message. That's what they're hearing from us.
My goodness. Well, what if, well, they're saying, you know, you get these little barbs that, well, we're going to take away Social Security and we're going to do this. And then there's this outrage. But when they do certain, oh gosh, certain acts, well, go back to the TPP. A lot of people are strongly against that. There's no way that they're not going to do it. You know, even in the face of, say, an onslaught of negative stuff from the public.
Well, you have a group of people who are committed to centralizing things. That's part of why they're doing the Trans-Pacific Partnership.
Yeah.
And they've decided they want to govern and operate the planet, or they want resources and operations governed and run essentially by corporations, not to say that corporate, that governments are going away.
Yeah.
But what we've done is we've shifted the assets into corporations and shifted the liabilities back into government.
Mm-hmm.
So corporations have gotten a global windfall, which is quite extraordinary.
Yeah.
And the governments are now saddled with the debt and the liabilities. Now, so the governments are going to shrink and the corporations are going to grow. So they're trying to set up a legal framework through which they can do that with ease.
Yes.
And that's why they're doing it. But it comes down to the root question, GeorgeAnn, which is, why are they so committed to centralization?
Yeah, why?
Why? And we don't know.
What's your best guess?
I think they are concerned that they need to organize and run this planet centrally because they need to deal with phenomena from outside the planet.
Uh-huh.
And they need to organize the resources to make planetary travel and operations feasible and economic. So they are going to use a significant amount of they want to rebalance the global economy because that's what it's going to take to basically get to a global world society.
Yeah.
And they're going to, as part of doing that, so that means a lot of capital is going to leave the developed world and go into the emerging markets and the frontier markets. But then they're going to pull from that the capital they need to go into space.
Mm-hmm. I think they're already out in space.
I think they're already out in space, but I think they're going to build a much more broad-based,
yeah,
and overt, you know, platform to go into space in size.
Yes, I agree. Yeah, I think that we've been secretly going to Mars, you know, for some time.
Well, but I would argue that it's a much better investment for us as a society to live much more modestly and do that.
Yes.
So to me, I, you know, the thing that really excited my generation was John F. Kennedy, you know, standing up and saying, let's go to the stars.
Yes.
We all thought we'd be in Mars in the 70s.
Yes.
And we probably were.
Yeah. Yeah, we either should have been or we were.
Or we were.
Yeah.
So to me, I don't object to the, you know, the notion of living more modestly and instead spending the money to go to Mars. I think the way in which it's being done is so, you know, to me, transparency is absolutely necessary to govern and grow a healthy society.
Yes.
And, you know, there may be compelling arguments not to have transparency. But again, I come back to the fact that we don't know why they're doing what they're doing.
Mm-hmm. I think that they want to create a whole new type of human being, or I wouldn't even call them human, but a new type of entity to carry out their service, you know. Stupid, just smart enough to follow orders. Never questioning anything. And I think that is part of it, Catherine.
Well, it's very hard when you look at a combination of GMO plus,
yeah,
fluoride plus chemtrails plus vaccines.
Yeah.
It's very hard to come up with a hypothesis which is not either creating automatons or depopulation.
I think it's both. I think it's both. There's a thing in the Old Testament where the spies went out into the land and they came back with these giant grapes. It took two men to carry one cluster. They were so huge. And I think that, you know, you have genetically modified food for genetically modified people.
Well, there's a lot of evidence to suggest we've been genetically modified,
mm-hmm,
for quite some time.
Yes, that's right. But we're going to go through another modification. I mean, is that possible?
I don't know. You know, I used to, when I first, you know, for years I didn't want to look at any of this stuff because I thought, you know, it's just too negative.
Yeah.
Why go there? Let me just do my thing. Let me enjoy my life.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I'm not a fighter. The last thing I ever expected to do is spend 11 years fighting with the,
yeah,
federal government. But
anyway,
well, because it's, you know, at some point you have to say, look, I'm not gonna make money genociding people. That's not my business.
Yeah.
And the other thing is, you know, I intend to be free. So if this is really about, am I a slave or am I free? Okay, well, then I guess we are gonna have to fight. So there are a couple core issues that I think are worth fighting for. But anyway, but what came out of all of that was realizing, look, you know, I'll be very blunt. Our souls are immortal.
Yes.
And we are here to, as the Buddha said, work out our salvation with diligence.
Yeah.
And I'm a Christian. I'm a very devout Christian. And I absolutely believe that spiritual forces are at work here. You know, this is the old good versus evil.
Yes.
And as Christians say, we have the victory. I think if you look at who's the most powerful force on the planet, it's the power, it's the divine intelligence, it's God, it's the power of love.
Yeah.
And the reality is we've all spent our lives in the middle of the road, and now we're going to have to choose.
Yes.
You know, and so I also know if we choose the divine, that is a force far more powerful than, you know, all the most powerful material and military forces on the planet.
That's right.
So.
Oh, I'm so glad that you said that, because I believe that too.
Right.
Yeah.
So I think that's the question. Ultimately, it's going to be the spiritual forces that decide what happened. They're the ones that have the power. And what we all have to do, it's funny, there have been many great moments on the Solari Report, but one of the greatest ones for me was I was interviewing Dr. William Tiller, and Dr. Tiller was the head of material sciences at Stanford and has done remarkable research on the power of intention to change material reality.
Oh, yeah.
And has proved, in fact, that, you know, when a group of people get together and shift their intention, material reality shifts.
Yeah.
And so I was talking to Dr. Tiller, and I said, you know, Dr. Tiller, I'm very interested in community prayer. What do you think? Assuming he would say, oh, it's wonderful. And he said, well, you have to be really careful. And I said, why is that? And he said, if the people doing the praying are coherent, it can help. If they're not, it makes things worse.
Yeah.
And I realized, oh, you know, the last thing I need to do is get all focused and worried about all these terrible things going on.
Mm-hmm.
What I need to do is just make sure I'm more coherent.
Yes.
That I'm as coherent as I possibly can be, because the more coherent people there are who are around, it's very interesting. If you look at all the people who were part of making the, you know, the guns win happen, you know, you're talking about millions of highly coherent people, many of whom are rarely involved in political activities.
Yes.
But they're very coherent. And when they, I call them the people of the line. You know, they're the people who run the line management operations in the country. When the people of the line say, no, we're not shifting to the right, guess what? You know? So, to me, when you get the people of the line in alignment with the divine intelligence, you know, miracles happen.
Yes.
So, I'm planning on miracles, and the reality is, if they don't happen, you know, we'll simply leave the material plane this time and come back around. So when we come back, GeorgeAnn, I just want you to promise you'll have me on your show.
Oh, boy. Oh, well, you know, years ago when I started this, a friend said, you need to write a book. How I started with no money, no talent, and no prospects.
You never know.
Yeah. Well, there are millions of... One thing that this Obama guy has done is wake up people. He is so awful. You know, that he has really stunned a lot of people, and they're taking a second and third look, and they don't like what they see. You know, stealing the pensions, stealing this, stealing that.
Well, Obama is, you know, the president... You know, Obama is basically a poodle on a leash.
Yes, yes.
So I know so many people who get mad at Obama, and, you know, I have a different perspective. because for many years the country was run by individuals who I associated with trying to kill me or someone in my family, or
yes.
killing somebody in my family.
Right.
So basically, you know, it's like having the mob run the country. And Obama was the first president in my lifetime who, you know, in my adult lifetime, who I didn't associate with killing somebody in my family. And he's also a different style. He's what I call a Ninja Turtle as opposed to a Lone Ranger. So, you know, he has a very pleasant style. So I thought, oh, what a relief. I get to have 4 or 8 years without, you know, somebody. Because you have no idea how irritating it is personally to have people who know your situation try and persuade you to give money or vote for somebody who, you know, killed or tried to kill somebody in your family. I mean, that's
And that's pretty rough.
That's pretty rough. So you know, and it doesn't make me mad at them. It makes me, you know, I say, what kind of mind control is occurring within my friends and family that they would do this? Anyway.
Yeah.
So it's very debilitating. Anyway, so to me, Obama was an enormous relief. Now, the problem with Obama that I was, you know, the most frightening part was the first election, where I knew that the guy had absolutely no power or capacity to deliver on any of these promises.
Right.
I mean, but here's the thing. All the people who believed them above a certain age, anybody over 40 who believed a word he said,
yeah.
you know, shame on you.
That's right.
I mean, there's no way that position can achieve those goals. And I was shocked to see people who I thought I'd educated with great care and ability, you know, who completely threw it out the window and said, oh, this guy's going to save. Well, no, he doesn't have, the position doesn't have the authority and resources to save you in the way that you're hoping for. Don't be ridiculous.
Yeah.
So I don't know what that was about, but let's say, okay, we're all naive fools, we have amnesia. How did they do it a second time? And then you have,
yeah.
you know, so he, you know, he proceeds to, of course, not, you know, because he can. I mean, let's face it, that he, you know, he's not in a position to deliver. So he doesn't deliver. Well, then they all vote for him again.
Yeah.
You know, and so the reality is, GeorgeAnn, you know, anybody who is frustrated with Obama but voted for him has only themselves to blame.
That's right.
Don't blame him. You
That's
know,
right.
you wanted the fantasy. You wanted the movie. He gave you the movie. He did a good job. You know, if it was a fiction, but everybody, I mean, there's no reason why you wouldn't know. I mean, I just, you know, it's inexcusable. So here's the thing about accountability. If you're not going to hold the people who do this accountable, you know, how many people do I hear who love one of the former presidents? Well, who do you think did that? I mean, where's the accountability?
Yeah.
So,
that's right.
You know, to me, this is a delusion that we all go through every 4 or 8 years, and it's time to stop the delusion.
Yeah. And then there's the issue, too, of, you know, the electronic voting machines.
Right.
You know, I mean, they can do anything with that, put anybody in they want, and I think they have a lot of that, you know, people are selected.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Well, if you look at the two, you know, generally if you look at the candidates on both sides, they've been vetted.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of times it is a real election in the sense that, you know, it's Mr. Global, you know, Blue and Mr. Global Pink, and
yeah.
you get to choose which one of Mr. Global's candidates you like.
Yeah, yeah.
So, and Mr. Global sees the benefit of that. I mean, he sees the benefit of a healthy debate and conversation and choices and people getting a chance. You know, the more you have a market, a true market, the healthier and more productive the optimization is. And I think, you know, to a certain extent, he understands and respects that.
Mm. Well, what if, you know, Democrat, Republican, they're two wings on a predatory bird. I mean, it doesn't make any difference who you vote for.
Well, but here's the problem. It's the red button problem, which I've talked about before. So let me tell you the story again. When it was summer of 2000, and an acquaintance had asked me to give a speech on how the money works in organized crime. mm-hmm. which later became my article, Narco Dollars for Beginners. And it's basically a light, funny description for people who want to know nothing about the darker side of life.
Yeah.
You know, the intersection between illegal cash flows and money laundering and Wall Street in Washington.
Yeah.
So I'm in the middle of the speech describing how congressional testimony in 1998, the dark alliance allegations about intelligence agency drug dealing into South Central L.A. And during that time, a reporter from the Department of Justice had told a reporter, public relations officer at the Department of Justice had told a reporter I was working with that the U.S. economy laundered $500 billion to $1 trillion a year of all illegal cash flows. Now with financial fraud, I think that number is much higher. But,
yeah.
You know, let's just take that number. So I said to this wonderful audience, the audience was Spiritual Frontiers Foundation, and they have a conference once a year, GeorgeAnn, to talk about how we can evolve our society spiritually. Very smart, very intelligent, very spiritually committed people.
Mm-hmm.
So I said to this wonderful group of spiritually committed people, what would happen if we stopped laundering $500 billion to $1 trillion a year of all dirty money?
Yeah.
And they said, well, you know, we would have trouble financing the government deficit. And we would, you know, that money might go to other stock exchanges around the world instead of to the United States.
Mm-hmm.
And we would, you know, we'd have real trouble because our, you know, our taxes might go up or our government checks might stop. So I said, okay, let's pretend there's a big red button up here on the lectern, and if you push that button, you can stop all hard narcotics trafficking in your neighbor, your county, your state, your country, tomorrow, thus offending the people who control all this money and the accumulated capital they're on for the last 50 years. I said, who here will push the button? And out of 100 people dedicated to evolving our society spiritually, guess how many would push the button?
I don't know.
One.
Oh.
So I said to the other 99, why would you not push the button? They said, we don't want our IRAs to go down in value.
Oh.
We don't want our government checks to stop. And we don't want our taxes to go up.
Yeah.
Now, if 99% of the most spiritually evolved people in the country will not push the red button, how in the world do you expect the president to push the red button? Because the president needs two things before he can push the red button. He needs 80% or more of the population supporting him and pushing it, mm-hmm. number one. And he needs, you know, plans at the county level in 3,100 counties getting ready to re-engineer the money at high speed when that money stops pumping through Wall Street in Washington.
Uh-huh.
Okay? So, you know, the problem is not just in Wall Street in Washington. It's in every county in America. We are all subsidized by this game.
Yeah.
And it is a very big and deep change to change the game.
Yeah. Yep, that's right. And people are very frightened of change.
Right.
Yeah. Well, talk about change. Look what Iceland has done. You know, they have recently put in jail some of their fraudster bankers.
Right.
And from what I understand, they are doing pretty well.
Right. Although I'm very loath to, I just saw an article this week on people saying, oh, isn't Iceland smart? They're crowdfunding a new constitution. Beware, because there is nothing Mr. Global would love than to get the you know, the drumbeat running in America to rewrite the Constitution in a crowdfunding open platform.
Yeah.
Because then Mr. Global gets to control what happens.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah.
And I've heard talk of that too, that we need a whole new system, you know, a new constitution.
No, we don't.
That's right.
No, we don't. Do not, never open that can of worms. Never touch that.
Right.
We have a covenant. If you break the covenant and then you turn it over to a process subject to all sorts of covert influences, big money, and entrainment.
Yeah.
You know, you think the Trans-Pacific Partnership is a problem. Wait till you see that.
Oh, boy. it would boggle a mind. Oh, my God. Oh, Catherine. Well, to switch countries a little bit, what is going on with the Vatican and their banking?
Wouldn't I love to know? Now, that is a story. If you look at the change at the Vatican over the last 12 months,
yeah,
you know, that is a huge story.
Oh, yeah.
And talk about an institution that's having to change its model at high speed. But, you know, we've known that the Vatican has essentially run a global money investment and money laundering network that,
yeah,
you know, is unparalleled. And here we have Francis throwing the bank open to transparency, bringing in outside auditors. I would have said that that was impossible, Georgia.
Yeah.
It could never have happened. And, of course, choking to death on all of the litigation settlements around the world over their control file system.
Mm.
So, you know, Francis has just been made Man of the Year in Time magazine. I haven't,
yes,
read the article yet, but this is unprecedented. And it's extraordinary. And where this goes, I'm not sure.
Oh, boy. Yeah, it's fascinating. It is just, Catherine, there are so many things going on.
I know. The
everywhere.
Speed, the speed is dazzling.
Yeah.
I think, you know, what's happening with the Vatican says that, if anything, it says that the Vatican is experiencing, I believe, significant deflation in the cash flows, and they are merging and getting closer to the other, you know, other institutions in a variety of different ways.
Mm-hmm.
And this is very much being driven by the more you centralize, the more you need to centralize.
Mm.
So there's a dynamic going on, and part of it is the technology as well. So I think the Vatican is undergoing big change. When many people, you know, hear the word Vatican, they think church. I don't think,
yeah,
church. I think the most significant global investment network on the planet.
And one of the best and most elite intelligence networks.
Yes.
Yeah.
Certainly one of the smartest.
Yep.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah. And you're talking about, you know, not just within the network, but, of course, back at the Vatican in the library, a repository of knowledge, which is arguably one of the most valuable in the world.
Mm-hmm.
You know, if the Vatican's intellectual capital and sort of knowledge chest was publicly traded,
yeah,
it'd be worth a lot more than Amazon.
Oh, boy. Well, you know, I listened to a video by Ken O'Keefe, and he's saying that everybody up there in Washington needs to be gotten rid of and tried for treason.
Oh, I disagree.
Okay, why?
I disagree because you have within the leadership and within the bureaucracy, to my amazement that they're still there, you have some remarkable people who have done everything they can and continue to do a good job.
Some of them, yes.
Yeah, so let me give you an example. Marcy Kaptur is a Democratic congresswoman from Ohio.
Mm-hmm.
I've made an effort to help raise money for her before I always get yelled at. You know, because there's invariably, with any leader, there's no way you can ever agree with 100% of their positions. And
right,
he's always saying, oh, you know, they're against plastic straws. How can you help somebody who's against plastic straws? Anyway, but I think Marcy Kaptur is one of the most remarkable Congress people who's ever walked the face of the earth. And she doesn't get a lot of media coverage because she's on our side.
Wow.
And she's smart, she's hardworking, she's effective, she's well-organized, and she's courageous. She's the one who got up in Congress and said, for the video camera, do not pay your mortgage, be a squatter in your own home.
Yep, bless her heart.
Make them produce the note. You know, fierce.
Yeah.
Fierce, but very, very capable, and, you know, and it's now has a fair amount of seniority. So I would no more want to replace Marcy Kaptur than the man in the moon. I like my congresswoman, Marsha Blackburn. She voted against the bailouts twice, and she was one of the Tea Party people on Obamacare. You know, we had everybody in the country saying these people are hideous. Well, they were trying to warn everyone.
Yeah.
And sure enough, when they lost and Obamacare went forward, the American people got a big welcome slap in the face about the fact that they were absolutely right. She comes out of small business. She's very knowledgeable about small business, very hardworking, very, you know. So, I've voted for Marsha Blackburn. I'm going to vote for her again. My favorite one is Al Gore got up to testify, and I thought by the time she was through with him, he was a little piddle on the floor. Anyway, and there are others. I think there are a lot of good people in the system. I worked, at the federal level in government, and I can't tell you how many great civil servants I ran into. If they had governance that would let them do the right thing, they know how to implement the law.
Yeah.
And they're very capable. So I don't feel that everybody up and down the line is my enemy. I don't think they are. I think we're all struggling to work inside of the red button problem. And I get very nervous about people attacking, the folks in the bureaucracy, whether it's Congress or the civil service, when in fact they don't want the red button pushed.
Yeah.
And it's the ultimate hypocrisy that says, look, I want my check. I want you to go around the world, control the sea lanes, run everything, beat everybody up for cheap natural resources. Give me my check, but I'm going to blame you for everything, all the ugly sides of what it is you're doing that I require you to do. So there's a hypocrisy. And the hypocrisy, needs to, I think everyone in America needs to come clean. I have, if you go to my blog at slurry.com, I've got an article called Coming Clean, Beyond the Fiscal Cliff.
Yeah.
And it goes into why the budget issues are so difficult to resolve and sort of the 22 big systemic issues that need to be faced. But until the general population starts to face these issues, you can't ask Washington and Wall Street to resolve it.
That's right.
Right.
You're right. And it's going to take a lot of waking up.
Yes.
To get people to do that.
Yes.
And I had another question I was going to ask you. When the government fines these big, huge corporations like BP, like Goldman Sachs, for their fraud and this and that, in the house foreclosures. Wait a minute. When they fine them hundreds of billions of dollars, what happened? Who gets the benefit of that money? Does the guy who was fraudulently foreclosed on get compensation?
Well, the bankers have been paid very, very well, clearly. But corruption is a cover story.
The what?
Corruption is a cover story. In other words, we decided as a society, national security policy, that we're going to pull an enormous amount of capital out of existing systems. Now,
yeah.
A lot of that was done with illegal methods or fraud.
Yes.
Now, I'm sure they've got some national security lawyer who'll say, he'll prove to me why, there's special exemptions, and so no, it wasn't all fraudulent. But if you look at the Constitution, it was outside the Constitution. If you look at the financial management laws of the United States government, it was outside those laws. If you look at the securities laws, it was outside of those laws. So to me, most of the $40 trillion got pulled out on an illegal basis, and that was a plan. And it was run from the top with coordination of all the different government agencies and policies. And the reality is, if you look at what they accomplished, it was one of the most extraordinary financial feats in the history of the planet.
Oh, yeah.
They did a great job.
Oh, geez.
I mean, the reason Lloyd Blankfein is, chairman of Goldman Sachs is, if you look at what he accomplished with, you know, suppressing the gold price and bringing up the housing bubble and engineering the whole thing.
Yeah.
You know, it was an extraordinary feat of financial engineering.
Oh, yeah.
So, and basically, you know, you stole $40 trillion out of the economy without the average person having a clue what was going on.
But they injured so many people, Catherine.
Well, I would say it differently. I mean, when you steal at that level in this way,
yeah,
you don't just injure, you kill.
Yeah.
Many people died or died much earlier than they would have otherwise.
Right.
This was war.
Oh.
Okay, it's no different than war. It's just by financial means.
Well, when they are taken to court and they
right,
have
but they didn't. What I'm saying is they did it as a matter of state policy. This was a society reengineering its governance systems. It was a financial coup d'etat. And so it wasn't a bunch of bankers, you know, making a lot of money so that they could have offshore accounts and Ferraris.
Yeah.
This was a society reengineering its systems and shifting a great deal of money out in a way that put that money in the service of a privately run governance system and a significant expansion of space and other special projects that to right now are secret.
Yeah.
But this wasn't, you know, this wasn't corruption. That's not what this was. Corruption is a cover story.
Well, but in one article that I read, the court said that they had to pay several hundred million dollars. Who gets that money?
Well, it depends, but either the Department of Justice or the appropriate government agency. So if the court rules in favor of the SEC or the court rules in favor of the Department of Justice or the Commodities Futures Trade Organization, depends on where these fees go.
Mm-hmm.
But then remember, you know, a big bank steals $1 billion. The money goes into the black budget. The bank makes, you know, let's say the bank makes $100 million. And then the enforcers come back and say, no, we want a kickback, so we get 50.
Oh, boy.
It's a public-private partnership, and I'm grossly oversimplified. You know, it took a public-private partnership to do the deal, and the Department of Justice wants their cut. It's just a way of kicking back their profits.
Oh, boy.
Now, I'm grossly oversimplifying.
Yeah.
And lots of different situations are different, but, you know, you can't have a housing bubble or securities fraud of the magnitude we had during the 90s without the Federal Reserve, Treasury, Wall Street, all the big institutions, the National Security Council, the intelligence agencies were critical,
yeah,
working and doing this together.
Mm. Oh, boy. So the people who lost their homes under fraudulent conditions receive no compensation. Is that what you're saying?
Right.
Oh, boy.
Now, what Mr. Global would say was, look, if they were careful and prudent, they probably wouldn't have lost their home.
Well, there's been cases of homes being foreclosed on that were paid for.
Right. And that didn't have a mortgage.
Yeah.
Right.
How can they do that?
Well,
I mean, that's a pretty slick trick.
Right. Now, the only case of that I've ever seen was reversed. You know, it was an enormous inconvenience for the homeowner, but
oh, yeah.
Reversed.
Yeah. Oh my gosh. Yeah, this thing is so huge, Catherine.
Well, but we're talking about something that's grown and grown and grown. If you look at the fraud, if you look at the housing bubble this time around, it all grew out of the fraud they did during Iran-Contra in the 80s.
Yeah.
And then that grew out of the fraud they did in the 70s. If you go back, there's a chain back to the 47 and 49 acts, mm-hmm. and the start of the black budget after 47, and the creation of the National Security Council. You know, I've written and talked about it. It's on the Salieri Report and various audio seminars. But, you know, each time the fraud gets worse. And what I've always said is crime that pays is crime that stays.
Yeah.
And each time we get around a fraud, you know, the reality is that the fraudsters have done a great job of spreading the money around. And everybody said, as long as I get my percentage of the action, I don't care. And the people who wouldn't do that, you know, basically get shot or destroyed or pushed into the corner.
Yeah.
And we continue to kind of soldier on pretending it's not really happening.
Oh,
but this fraud has been evolving since 1947, and it's just, it's like a cancer. It keeps growing.
And it involves the state of Israel.
Well, no, but let me be the bad guy. It involves every family, every household, every person. I live in a county which is overrun with illegal narcotics.
Yeah.
Okay. Have you ever seen the TV show Breaking Bad?
No.
I mean, Breaking Bad is about the fact that, you know, and here's the reality. You know, the economy works bottom up.
Yeah.
So if you're going to do this stuff, you're going to do it one county at a time. The housing fraud, the mortgage fraud, all of this stuff has to be done one county at a time. And if we want to face things and change them, what we need to do is take a look in our own pocketbooks, in our own households, in our own counties, where is this happening and how do we, you know, stop it? Because, you know, the way you stop it is you shift the cash flows at the root.
Yeah.
And we have the power. You know, here's my question, GeorgeAnn. I understand why the banks did what they did, but why are the American people still banking at those banks?
Yeah, I'd like to know.
Well, yes. But that's where our power is. Our power is when we shift the cash flows, and we have that power.
Yeah. Yeah, that's right. People can buy money orders and pay their bills.
There's thousands of things we can all do.
What do you think about Bitcoin?
I think Bitcoin is Mr. Global's favorite pathway to getting a digital global currency.
Yeah, I kind of
so
agree.
I think it's a Trojan horse.
Yeah.
The Royal Mint in England is talking with the Channel Islands about doing a gold-backed Bitcoin,
mm-hmm.
and that will give them sound money, which they can then hold everybody accountable. It'll be perfect. And with a complete digital record, which will, I believe, be available to the powers that be. So,
yeah.
I wouldn't touch Bitcoin with a 10-foot pole. I mean, if you want to understand how it works, so you try it to see how it works. But, you know, you should assume, you should only put money into Bitcoin that you're prepared to lose 100% of.
Yeah.
And you're prepared for Mr. Global to know 100% of your business.
Right. Right. Yep, I knew it. I knew it. Oh, my gosh. Oh, Catherine. This is, you know, it's like Disneyland on steroids. It just is.
Well, no, I would say, if you've ever seen John Carpenter's movie, They Live?
Yes.
A little bit like They Live.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Just put on your glasses, folks. Oh my gosh.
Uh-huh.
Oh, Catherine. Fascinating stuff, I'll tell you. Ah. So, Bitcoin is out. Unless you are planning on losing money.
No, I don't think you'll necessarily. Here's the problem. Your exchange, your particular website.
Yeah.
Whether your laptop gets destroyed or you know, the exchange that you're on gets destroyed. I mean, there are a variety of different ways that you could get wiped out.
Yeah.
The politics of this thing are the politics could turn and you'd get wiped out. So you have specific digital systems risk, and then you have political risk.
Yeah.
And the thing is wildly volatile. So, and you also know that you're using your money and time to prototype, you know, Mr. Global's way of controlling you.
Yeah, That's right. What do you think of gold and silver?
Well, I think gold and silver play an incredibly important role, gold particularly at the central banking level, and certainly operate as a, gold and silver coins operate as a useful insurance. We're in a particularly bad year for the precious metals market. We don't know which way it's going to be. So I just posted an article for my subscribers. It's called What Percentage of Your Assets Should You Hold in Precious Metals? And basically what I advise people is divide your holdings between an investment position and an insurance position, I mean a core position, and the core position is the gold you have to basically bribe the border guards.
Yeah.
You know, that's your insurance money.
Yeah.
And what I said is until the primary trend is proven one way or the other, you should only be in core, and I'd be very careful about investment positions.
Mm.
So I don't think the price consolidation is necessarily over, and we need to reprove the primary trend before anybody takes any big investment positions is what I would say.
Oh, boy. Ooh. Well, I don't have any money to invest in anything, but we will survive.
No, we're going to do better than that.
You think so?
Yeah, we have to have a better... You know, if your intention is just to survive, that's what you'll get.
Yeah.
No, I think we have to have a, you know, my intention is to survive and thrive.
Yes. Yes, I should have added that. Yep, that's right. That is true. Oh, Catherine. So, you think, how long do you think it will take them just off the top of your head, how long do you think it'll take them to finalize their global plan?
I have no idea. I mean, you have different factions and different groups and all sorts of things going on. I think it's very organic and evolving.
Where do you think we're at in that, in the overall plan?
Well, I think the centralization in the last 30 years has been remarkable.
Mm-hmm.
And if you look at what you've done is you've stolen a great deal, or you shifted a great deal of money with a financial coup d'etat. And what you've done with the bailouts and quantitative easing is you've basically destroyed the legal record.
Yeah.
And that means the money is a, you know, is now away, because it's not enough to get the money. You have to get it and keep it and destroy the legal record by which anybody could get it back.
Oh, boy.
And that plus the statute of limitations run out. And so now I think they're free and clear, and they're moving to really reinvest to build the space platform and to make the changes they want to make. And if you look at how they're doing, I think in terms of making the changes they want to make in the governance system, for example, in North America, I think they found it to be a much harder slog than they would like, and it's just a hard slog. So, for example, the gun thing slows them down.
Well, that's a good thing.
Right. So, I think it's evolving, and they try things. You know, Bitcoin is a prototype.
Mm-hmm.
Doesn't mean, you know, it'll get adopted. But I think they try things and they see, and so it's evolving.
Well, gosh. So people are going to be going to Mars. People are going to be going to the moon. And there will be people here, and it's really going to be an interesting world.
Well, it's always been an interesting world.
Yep.
It's always been an interesting world where, you know, it's a little bit like the Truman Show.
Yeah.
At the end, Jim Carrey opens the door and walks off of the TV set and into reality.
Yeah.
So the human race is going to leave the movie set, and we're going to walk into reality.
Well, do you think that there's, I mean, there's so much talk and so much propaganda. Do you think they're going to have concentration camps, they're going to put people in and all that kind of thing?
I can't fathom. You know, if the Nazis proved anything, it's that that model wasn't economic.
Yeah.
So if you look at the war on drugs, if you look at bringing drugs in and then the war on drugs into a community,
yeah,
you know, you achieve the same result, but it's much more profitable.
Yeah.
You know, it's kind of like a for-profit
version.
So, you know, putting people in camps where you have to feed them and, you know, whatever,
yeah,
is much more expensive than if they're self-maintaining and you can entrain them and instruct them through an iPhone that they pay for.
Yeah.
You know, so I don't, you know, I just don't see that. That's, you know, if you look at that infrastructure, if it exists, it's because their fear of a Katrina. In other words, you have these situations where you could get mass, you know, if you get a major earthquake, blah, blah, blah.
Yeah.
So I don't, you know, or if they can't succeed at stopping the riots. I mean, if the food supply should ever
collapse.
Well, I'm not, it's not collapse, but if you have really severe weather.
Yeah.
And you get dislocations in the food supply, you could have real problems because you have a population that's not used to real trouble.
Yeah, that's right.
So, I, you know, if you're the government, you need to be prepared for the worst case.
Yep.
And the worst case is you need to be prepared for significant food riots. We've had them all around the world, and we're suffering through a very significant drought in this country.
Mm.
So, I just think that's government being prepared. And because if you look at basically the economics and the logistics of trying to put a lot of people in camps like that, you know, it's very bad. It's much easier to do it with them running around, you know, in a much more economic form.
Yeah. Good answer. Wow. Yeah, there's a lot of what they call fear porn out there, and I just find it real hard to buy into it.
Well, I don't. Here's where I get back. You know, I think you can engage in conjecture about all these things forever.
Yeah.
And at some point, it's a complete waste of time.
Right.
We don't understand who's governing this planet. We don't understand how the governance system works. And until we do, we're operating completely in the dark in an unproductive way. So to me, priority number one is to figure out who's really running things and why are they behaving the way they're behaving. What does the world look like from their point of view? What does it feel to sit in their shoes and look at the world from their point of view? And until we understand that, we're no place. So to me, I would much rather try and figure out what's going on and getting to the bottom of that than just, you know, engaging in conjecture about this particular symptom or that particular symptom.
Well, they keep building these prisons, and we have the highest incarceration rate in the world, and CCA is saying, look, if you will guarantee us a 90% fill rate, we'll build a prison in your town, and we'll give you all jobs.
Well, I think the prison model started when the planning to shift manufacturing and a lot of the jobs either to automation or abroad hit, and they realized, you know, we don't have jobs for any of these people.
Right.
So, and that, you know, that's tied into the war on drugs and how that all evolved and, you know, converting those people into not people who are not allowed to vote, et cetera. So I think that was kind of social engineering.
Yeah.
And it gets back to the fundamental issue, which is who's governing, why are they behaving the way they're behaving, where are they going, what's their goal?
Yeah.
So, but I guess what I'm saying is we can sit around and we can bemoan the different symptoms and we can conjecture as to why the different symptoms exist, But it's much easier to just say, look, all of these are symptoms of a governance system and a governance plan, and why don't we just get to the bottom of what that is and why it is, and then we can come back and deal with all these different symptoms.
Well, do you think it's possible to ever know, to get to the bottom of all this?
Of course. Of course.
Hmm.
Of course. The Bible says in a twinkling of an eye.
Yeah.
Absolutely, I believe it's possible. If everybody wants to know and is willing to collaborate on figuring it out and, you know, just continually moving up the chain and saying, excuse me, why are you doing this? You know, we have all the laws and powers that we need to get complete transparency of what's going on and why.
Wow. Yeah, you're right. But they're not obeying their own laws.
Okay, so I'm just going to be a tough guy right now.
Okay.
Okay, we all bank. We can pull our deposits.
Right.
We can all switch our purchases.
Yes.
We all have all sorts of influence with the different pots of money, whether it's an endowment at a not-for-profit or a university. We all have all sorts of financial relationships, and we have family relationships. We can say, look, until you tell me what's going on at this agency, I'm not having dinner with you and I'm not speaking to you.
Right.
I'm not dating you. I won't have sex with you. I mean, we know, you know, you've seen the play Lysistrata. When the Greek woman wanted to get something done, they just withheld sex.
Yeah.
So we have all the tools at our disposal to hold each other accountable to dish out the truth.
That's, you're right.
So, you know, I think sitting around whining about, you know, oh, you know, why are they doing what they're doing? Well, get down to the county level. They are us. They are our friends, our family, our neighbors. These are us. We're doing this.
Hmm. You're absolutely right, Catherine. Absolutely right.
Right. Oh, Mr. Global didn't build the concentration camps. We did.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's right.
Mr. Global didn't engineer the mortgage fraud. We did.
Mm-hmm.
Mr. Global, you know, all this stuff we did. So, you know, if we did it, we have the power not to do it.
Yeah, that's right. Wow. Give out your website again.
Solari.com, SOLARI.com. And my online book is Dylan Reed and the Aristocracy of Stock Profits. And that's at dunwalkie.com, DUNWALKE.com.
Wow. Yes, I like your website. It's very easy to navigate. It loads quick. It's really snappy.
Oh, well, I'm glad you like it.
It's very good. Well, Catherine, I hope you'll come back.
I will come back, and I hope you have a wonderful holiday season.
Yes. Getting over my coughing. I apologize to everybody and to you, Catherine, for starting out with this raspy throat.
Uh-huh.
Oh, my goodness. Well, don't hang up. Everybody go to Solari.com and get a copy of Catherine Austin Fitz's book. And she has Catherine, you also have a private consultation service, don't you?
Well, we publish something called the Solari Report, which is a interview, and we do a series of audios every week.
Mm-hmm.
One is an interview with a person, and then we do something called Money and Markets.
Yes.
And it's focused more on the financial world and the financial markets. And it's lots of wonderful resources. So it's really a subscription service.
And how much is that?
It's $30 a month or $275 a year or $160 for 6 months.
That's very reasonable. And you are a very highly intelligent lady. I mean, just a real bombshell.
Ooh. Oh, dear.
Absolutely. So go to Solari.com and get acquainted with Catherine Austin Fitz, her website, her subscription service, and you'll be money ahead. Absolutely. So God bless everybody out there that's listening. Good night.
Good night.